Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the second day of the Inheritance Conference. I'm Marissa Brown, the Assistant Director for Programs at the John Nicholas Brown Center for Public Humanities and Cultural Heritage at Brown University. I hope a lot of you here today were able to make it to some of the, or most of the sessions on Zoom yesterday and to the fabulous opening reception for Jasmine Lee Johnson's Not Nevermore, a true magnum opus printed textile installation on the ground floor of our department here at the Center for Public Humanities. Jazz will be one of the speakers in our first panel today. So those of you who were here will get to hear her speak about it, and those who weren't will get a glimpse through her presentation of this important artwork. Before we begin, it's important to address the issue of land occupation and restitution. As Brown University works to establish an official land acknowledgement with our colleagues at the Native American and Indigenous Studies Initiative, one that recognizes the Narragansett Indian tribe, its history and stewardship of these lands, and that I hope creates meaningful action today, we should be clear about the ways that this center has benefited from displacement, settler colonialism, and slavery. There is no center without these things. What we do today about this history is a question we must all answer to ourselves and to those ancestors who came before us. Today, we begin with a session titled Artists and Counternarratives. This is such a superstar panel, and it gets to the question of what role the arts and contemporary artists can and do play in either promoting or disrupting notions of racial identity and history. Before we begin, a few quick notes about Zoom. If you're joining us for the first time today, feel free to submit any questions or comments as they occur to you in the Q&A box, which you can open by clicking the icon at the bottom of your screen. The session's moderator has access to that box and will draw from it when she moderates panel conversations at the end of the session. Another note, the chat box is open to all, so feel free to use that box to introduce yourself and tell others where you are Zooming in from today. With that, I'll turn it over to Sophia Ellis, who is a second year graduate student in the Public Humanities Department, and she will introduce our speakers and moderator. Sophia.
Hi, everyone. It is my pleasure to be here today to introduce these extraordinary scholars, curators, artists, as we work towards thinking of otherwise in futurity within empire and American imperialism. Our first speaker, Jasmine Lee Johnson, who was also one of my professors, is a visual artist, scholar, composer, and curator. Her current work, Not Nevermore, Remixing Historic Wallpaper, is currently on display at the John Nicholas Brown Center for Public Humanities and Cultural Heritage. Her practice centers on the interplay of animation, printmaking, music, and dance, informed by a yearning to understand how current circumstance is tethered to the trauma of the past. Our second speaker, Jasmine Nichole Cobb, is a professor of African and African American studies of art, art history, and visual studies at Duke University, and a co-director of the From Slavery to Freedom, Franklin Humanities Lab, and editor for African American Literature in Transition, 1800 to 1830. She is also the author of Picture Freedom, Remaking Black Visuality in the Early 19th Century, and New Growth, The Art and Texture of Black Hair After Emancipation. Our third speaker, Michelle D. Commander, is an associate director and curator at the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture in Harlem, New York. She is the author of Afro-Atlantic Flight, Speculative Returns, and The Black Fantastic, and Avid Reads Passages. She is also the editor of Unsung, Unheralded Narratives of American Slavery and Abolition. Our moderator, Kate Kraczon, is the director of exhibitions and chief curator at the David Winton Bell Gallery at Brown University, where she oversees the Brown Arts Institute's exhibition program, which includes the Bell and its collection of over 7,000 works at List Art Center, the Cohen Gallery in the Grandoff Center for Creative Arts, and Brown's robust public art program. I would also like to direct you to the Inheritance Conference's website to get a complete bio and bios of the panelists and moderators.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Jasmine Lee Johnson. I use she, her, hers pronouns, and you can call me Jazz. I'm really, really excited to start this conversation today, and I just want to jump right into it. So I'm going to take a moment to share my screen and we can get into it. My piece is called Not Nevermore. It's a response to the historic wallpaper that is up currently at the JMBC. And looks like this. So I first encountered this wallpaper as a student in 2013, studying public humanities in this space, in this house, this historic house, which was previously owned by the Browns. And when I first came in, I definitely had a reaction. It's large, it's beautiful, it's stunning. But also it's extremely problematic. And for me, as a student, as one of the first members of my family to not only go through an undergraduate degree, but then move on to go to grad school and already feel, you know, these spaces are really hard for me. And sometimes I felt unwelcomed as someone being first generation going through college, but also as an artist in academia, et cetera. So to encounter this space, already feeling uncomfortable and like I needed to prove that I belonged there, it was really jarring. So I was really pleased when Marissa reached out to me to respond to this wallpaper. And if I could give just a couple of details about the wallpaper in terms of who made it, when it was made. It's an early 19th century wallpaper that was made by a French design house called Zuber. This wallpaper is really idealistic, romantic. It's called The Views of North America, and it shows sort of this utopian imagery of America in the early 19th century. Not only is it housed at the Nightingale Brown House in Providence, where public humanities, the public humanities department is housed, but it's also in the White House in the diplomatic reception room. So coming in to the White House from all parts of the world, you're also surrounded by this architecture that shows these ideals of the United States. So there are five main motifs in the wallpaper. And what I'm gonna do is just take you through the original wallpaper and then my remix, my disruption. So the first motif that I'll share with you is the view of New York from New Jersey, which you can see here, zoom in a little bit. One of the details of this is this seemingly harmless courtship that's taking place. And this is one of the, in some ways, blatant imagery that's just inaccurate, I would argue. This imagery is a direct, I would say, pull from this series of prints by Edward Williams Clay called Life in Philadelphia. And it features Black people dressed fancily and trying to assimilate and be similar to white culture at the time, dress fancy, speak a certain way, and sort of stumble over that in their clothing and in their language. And the intervention that I made for that panel is right here. Now, there's a lot going on here. There are a lot of layers and such, and I just wanna sort of briefly go over what's going on here, and then I'll get in more detail for one specific panel to take you through the whole process. But just to give you an overview, my view of New York from New Jersey features three main panels or imagery. This being imagery of persons, including myself here, destroying the Half Moon, which was the boat that Henry Hudson sailed on. It was a Dutch vessel that he sailed in his first encounter with what is now known as New York, but is, from an indigenous perspective, Lenape Hogan land. And even places like Manhattan have histories, you know, have implications of the people who were originating in those spaces, in those geographies. So this is my possibility of imagining the destruction of that ship, of that vessel, and sort of what would have happened if it never came, if what we now call the Hudson Valley was not that. So that's that imagery there. This imagery here is my take on basically the fact that even though in that motif we see Black and white people living in harmony, probably one would assume at the same financial level, at the same level in society, was not the case. We're talking early 19th century, we're talking pre-Civil War, and even in places like New York, we're thinking about slave codes and Black codes that limited Black bodies, how many people could gather, how much land you could own, who could marry who, what kind of jobs you could have. All that stuff was going on. There are even things around the Fugitive Slave Act, which continued to control Black bodies and their attempts at freedom and movements towards freedom. So I explore that here with this imagery as well, and I'll zoom in a bit so we can see what's going on. As well as thinking about present day culture, motifs from things like the Capitol riots of January 6th and how to this day, we're still dealing with race relations and people's intentions around what they want this country to be and who owns what and such. I also present my own family, my mom, my grandmother, and my great grandmother in this work, just to bring them into this space. So that's what I'll share about that panel of my view of New Jersey. And then finally, this last panel sort of gets to this idea that, you know, after enslavement, there was all this prison labor and how it feeds into the prison industrial complex of today. How, you know, broadsides and posters such as this one down here limits Black bodies, as well as this over here. I don't know if you can see my cursor, but it's from the NAACP stating that, you know, lynchings were still happening beyond the time of this, the original wallpaper. So there's a lot in there. And I invite you to, of course, come to Brown to view it in person. But I want to move on to the next motif because we don't have much time and there's a lot to get through. So the second one is the view of West Point Military Academy, which is in upstate New York. And West Point to this day is a military academy where many high ranking officers go to train. Westport Military was really a huge part of the efforts of the Civil War on the part of the Union Army. And after the Civil War, they formed the 9th and 10th Cavalries, which were what some people loosely call the Buffalo Soldiers. And for me, my response around the West Point Military Academy was thinking about westward expansion. When the Buffalo Soldiers were formed, they were in charge of taking over indigenous land and indigenous people's lives and bodies and expanding colonialism. And I think that is complicated and nuanced and fraught to be formally enslaved and then working in the efforts to expand. And so this piece explores that notion. It explores westward expansion in terms of locomotives, how the railroad system was built and connected the East to the West towards the end of the 19th century. There are lots of bison, which for me also represents sort of expansion, the West, and also this particular like American colonial appetite to make room for cattle and cow culture as opposed to the bison, and what it means to wipe out the bison as well as certain Native and Indigenous groups of the West Coast. So that's a quick read on there. Next up is the view of Boston Harbor. So here we are in New England. We see trade, we see water. And for me, the first thing that comes to mind is the myth that the North was not implicated in slavery in the same ways that the South was. So while there wasn't plantation slavery in the same ways we think about it in the South, the North was greatly a part of the slave trade, especially the business of it. We think about even the Brown family and rum and sugar and how rum was traded to buy slaves, how sugar was used from the sugar slavery, I guess, in the Caribbean, and that was used to make the rum and it being this circle. So what I wanted to do for my response in this particular section was just move beyond the motif and the idea that, well, I guess presents the idea that there was slavery, there was the business of slavery in this region. And it was really important to the machinery and to the system of slavery. But I also wanted to expand my ancestors' narrative, thinking both of water, of moon, of land, of dance, and the body being free, because I do believe that dance is truly an embodied utopia, a true form of freedom. So this is essentially a dance party moving beyond the slave ship. This motif appears twice at the Nightingale Brown House. So I've done a blue version as well as a green version. Moving right along, here is the view of the Natural Bridge, which is in Shenandoah, Virginia. This motif also appears twice at the Nightingale Brown House. Super problematic. It doesn't represent any specific group of Native peoples. You see Black and white onlookers watching this exoticized performance taking place. And so my response to this, and being a mom and thinking about the next generation and thinking about these histories, is just how important it is to speak truth and to tell the truth about the past. So I wanted to bear young people and the next generation in mind when we think about and we learn about these histories and these narratives. So I have a series of young people, and the gaze is really important to me in this motif in particular, because I wanted to shift the gaze of the original wall people and the onlookers looking at the performance to the gaze being us, the audience who are looking onward, and also these young people sort of looking to us as people who are stewards, who are ushering us into the future. So they have their little bit of swag and they're looking at us like, what's up? Very important, you are on Native land. And this is something that I presence actually in all the pieces, and I'll share that more in a second. But these are the digital versions or the digital mock-ups before the actual printed pieces were made. And there's all kinds of stuff in here, again, around documents of the time that spoke to race relations. There was even a health bulletin in Virginia that was around legalizing eugenics, for lack of a better word. It was around racial integrity and mixing and clearing the race. I have the monarchy up here at the top, because I found it really interesting in doing some research around Natural Bridge that Jefferson owned the Natural Bridge. What does that mean? And who did he buy it from? And so I presence that narrative. All right, I have to move quickly because my time is almost up. View of Niagara Falls here. For me, again, it's a presencing of both Black and Indigenous and Native people's stories of their histories. So here I talk about dams and Niagara Falls being a dam and how dams have actually historically displaced Indigenous people in many ways, drowned them out of their own communities, even though in some ways they could be seen as a great natural resource. I present Harriet Tubman here and thinking about, you know, freedom and the last river to cross before true freedom, because even though, again, we think of the North, we think of New York, this is a place where you can move around freely. There were still ways in which people were legally enslaved. And so I presence her. And then just thinking of this bigger picture of nature and land and colonialism and patriarchy and how it influences and dictates sort of nature and how that is echoed in the ways in which women's bodies are governed and treated and managed and controlled. So I have over here a natural birth happening. And lastly, I don't know if you can see this, but this comes from an old broadside, again, from the 19th century, talking about the environmental implications of tourism and such of Niagara Falls and what that does. So with not much time left, the last thing that I wanna share, I can't believe there's so much to say on this, and I really encourage you, if you're able to see the work in person. But even though, so one thing that you can't see in the digital versions that I shared with you is the fact that this is printed on a sheer textile. I use screen printing. I was really interested in quilting and other adornments and applique to presence both Black and Indigenous traditions of making and storytelling. So things like this, where this is the digital version, this would be the actual this is what it looks like. You can see parts of the original, or I should say the historic 19th century wallpaper. Some parts really clear, some parts not as clear. There are all sorts of adornments and applique that aren't in the digital mockups that I put throughout the piece to again presence the narratives of who were the people who existed in this space and in this land before colonialism struck. So just to give you a sense of what it looks like in person. And I guess I'll leave it at that. There's so much more that I want to say. There's so many conversations to be had. And I'm looking forward to our dialogue as this panel goes on.
Good morning. I want to start by thanking Marissa Brown and the Center for Public Humanities and Jazz for the intervention that you provide us with. So much about this work of the Inheritance Symposium is important, in part because I think we're getting a great model of how to live with complicated objects and our opportunities for intervention as we move forward. The work I present today is some stuff I've shared at the Center for Public Humanities at Brown in the past, and a way of thinking forward alongside other panelists here. Let's see. So across publications, I've written extensively about views of North America, the wallpaper that sits behind Jazz's really important intervention. Views of North America, as I've shared in this work and in other conversations, draws on a number of materials, but in part this really problematic caricature produced by Philadelphia artist and lawyer Edward Williams Clay. Racial caricaturist Edward Williams Clay illustrated Black freedom with a popular lithographic series, Life in Philadelphia, depicting free Blacks engaged in ridiculous forms of civic and domestic life. Clay's vision of Black freedom emphasized elaborate dress and improper speech to portray free people as foolhardy and self-important. His illustrations positioned people of African descent as ill-prepared to experience liberty or autonomy. Clay portrayed sightings of Blacks about town with the illustration of 14 colored lithograph sheets packaged in brown paper for viewers to enjoy in sequence. Life in Philadelphia expressed distaste toward wealthy free Blacks by ridiculing their speech, dress, and what Clay deemed as free Blacks' unwarranted sense of self-importance. So I take great effort to flesh out that Clay's issue is not just with free Black people in general, but it's free Black people who have the means to build institutions, to educate their children, and take care of their community. And he's living in close proximity to them at the time he produces Life in Philadelphia, which is widely popular and reproduced many times over. So you'll see variations in coloring, in the size of the figures rendered in the illustrations, how they appear in the background. But they'll always be shown engaging in these scenes of ridiculousness with this malapropic speech depicted at the bottom of the image. So popular, one variation of Clay's original images gets reproduced in London, but holds on to all of the same sort of features about speech and dress and foolishness that appear in the original, but the scene gets improved upon with advancements in British printing techniques used in the early 19th century. But I like to share this variation as a way to flag just how far reaching Clay's original life in Philadelphia was that it was printed across the Atlantic. And eventually, in its traveling the Atlantic world, moved into artist renderings. French artist Jean-Julien Datil created the painting based off of Life in Philadelphia in 1834. This image of an exotic US landscape, a unique mix of race and republic called together by the implementation of US democracy, became popular when the French wallpaper company Zubair et C. reissued the item for home installation. Datil painted scenes of North American landscape as home to cordial race relations among whites, Blacks, and Native Americans. Using 32 different panels in 223 colors, Zubair transcribed views into a scenic wallpaper with 1,690 hand-carved woodcut blocks that could cover a wall from floor to ceiling. Traditionally, when you encounter this wallpaper, such as in the Nightingale Brown House, it is installed above a chair rail. And so the figures are somewhat eye level or near the rail, and then upward is the sky and these other landscape inclusions. For our purposes today, views is my entree into thinking about the decorative arts as a site for the sedimentation of slavery's peculiar ocularity. At once relying on Black people's visibility and whiteness as invisible all at once. In my first book, I argue that picturing freedom was a domesticating project that helped viewers of the Atlantic world maintain continuity across diverse notions of home through complicated illustrations of free Blacks. So central among this domesticating project were images about Black people in particular, who were objects used to sever the relationship between freedom and citizenship. Across a few chapters, I talk about the way in which people became accustomed and comfortable to the idea of abolition some 30 years before the Civil War, was to think about ways in which the public could cordon off citizenship from a free Black population. In this practice, images such as views have been a site for the sedimentation of slavery's peculiar ocularity, at once relying on Black people's visibility and the invisibility of whiteness all at once. My contribution to today's discussion is to simply contextualize the racism in the decorative arts, which have been shaped in part by the placements of Black peoples in such works, but also the location for these material cultures. So as Jazz was so kind as to share with us her personal experience of views as a student trying to navigate this space, tells us a lot about how these objects function in the contemporary. They are part of creating an experience of exclusion for some and inclusion for others. Similar to public monuments, decorative arts are rife with racist portrayals and remain in circulation, prominent as acceptable representations that bend and evolve to more modern contexts. So what I find sort of personally fascinating about views is that it's this historic piece that is rolled out in 1834, Jacksonian America, with all the problems entailed therein. And then it sort of keeps on giving to the present by what happens in spaces where the wallpaper is located. And I think it is a roadmap for us thinking about what do we do with these things now and how they are able to constantly reinvigorate the problems of race embedded in the image. Similar to public monuments, decorative arts rife with racist portrayals remain in circulation, prominent as acceptable representations that bend and evolve to more modern contexts. The reckoning we see as we're called to think about these materials, is a reckoning about composition and consumption of racist material. So I've already shared a bit about what's wrong with the image, and Jazz tells us about this as well, that we see, you know, not only a scene that falsely suggests free Black people are able to socialize and take up the public, but it's based on caricature. So the inspiration for the illustration is one of racial animus. But when we think about the decorative arts writ large and how Black people are composed therein, these sort of problems reoccur across diverse materials, and they share in common their location in places that are not just about the exclusion of Black people, but also about white enjoyment at the expense of others. So in the case of Views, when it reemerges as part of its White House installation, I've written about this in the publication, the Journal of Public Culture. The installation of Views in the White House is not just a sort of sentimental installation taken up unknowingly by First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy, but instead Views is part of a very tightly run public campaign about art and decor and race for the Kennedy White House. The public is shown images of Views being installed, like this figure, this Black and white figure you see here. Newspapers and magazines ran stories about the installation of Views. And it was, I argue, part of a strategy to counter the mediation of racial inequality and state-sanctioned violence against Black activists in the 1960s. Against the backdrop of a highly mediated struggle for Black liberation, First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy resurrected the Wall House as part of her White House restoration project and installed the material in the diplomatic reception room of the John F. Kennedy White House. And in my essay, I write about just how labor intense this project was, and how unnecessary that laborious endeavor was, and that it could have been easier, but there was a real commitment to showing this as important historical excavation work. Kennedy debuted Views in a tightly managed campaign about her transformations to the first residence, which included a cover feature for a Life magazine story, as well as a televised tour of the White House for CBS. For a tour of the White House with Mrs. John F. Kennedy, which aired on February 14, 1962, the First Lady walked cameras and CBS correspondent Charles Collingswood through the newly reconditioned home. For 60 minutes, she presented, quote, outstanding examples of American art and furniture, end quote, from across the country, which according to the Kennedy Library, she hoped would help viewers develop, quote, a greater appreciation for the history of America's most famous residents, end quote. An estimated 56 million viewers tuned into the White House tour. This particular placement for Views, I think, is important because it keeps us in touch with the white viewing public, as well as guests to the White House, as the sort of focus for having such material installed and maintained in the White House. It illustrates for us whose enjoyment is central in organizing and maintaining a material like Views of North America. And it appears in many random places I have found that often sort of reiterate the problems that Jazz lays out for us. One example is the Yale Club of New York City, which has since removed the item since 2016, I think in effort to avoid some of the complication that arises from these materials. But I've seen it in many different places. And I think they all carry with it this shared complication. This kind of life for these items got me to thinking about not just the composition of the images, how people are composed within them, but the scenes of white enjoyment that happen in front of them. And I think it's important for us to think about that, not just what the image looks like, but what is the experience created around it. I think the pictures sort of speak for themselves. And then the interventions that heroes like Corey Menifee make when deciding to do something like damage the stained glass windows at formerly Calhoun College at Yale University, pushing us to really think about what are the ways in which we interact with these materials and what are the activist opportunities presented by them or we are faced with now in this period of reconsidering and removing objects. And I think what jazz gives us is something so on point, not just because it's beautiful and transforms the space, but it's such a hands-on and direct way of reminding us that historic objects are no more sacred than the people that interact with them and move through the spaces they're in. So when we're faced with reimagining decorative arts, we're considering the composition of the images and the items and spaces organized around them. And what Jazz's work does is join up with other artists who are thinking about not only how can we change materials that we can't remove or have yet to be removed, but what are the ways in which we can deal with material culture and decorative arts to sort of put forward the stakes of their making and the opportunities for transformation. Her work reminds me of artists like Colin Quashie, whose French toile, Negro Toil, is part of a series that reimagines plantation living through toile, an 18th century European fabric still popular today. Many of the leisure scenes suggested in common early toile, and you will have seen these scenes of lying in a garden or sipping tea, ignore the kind of pain and degradation required to produce what Simon Gikandi has called the culture of taste. Artists who are reimagining materials intervene in our assumptions about decorative arts as benign. Quashie's print points us to the ways in which pain financed by toil produced toile. Likewise, artist Renee Green, in collaboration with the Fabric Workshop and Museum in Philadelphia, Meeson Scene, reminds us that the making of these materials then produced further comfort, used as upholstery, filling out a space, and really putting forward the ways in which enjoyment and leisure and pleasure have been built on this sort of racialized background. And art making, particularly by Black artists, rethinking decorative arts gives us an opportunity to rethink the present and the past. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Michelle Commander, and I am grateful to be here today to speak with you about Before Yesterday We Could Fly, which is an Afrofuturist period room at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City. I am going to share my screen with you all. Get started. So I served as consulting curator for this new period room at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, which opened in November 2021. Our lead curator for this show is Hannah Beekler, who is the Academy Award winning set designer for the film Black Panther. And of course, she's done other films before and since Black Panther was released a few years ago. The Met-based curators, who some of you may already know personally, and include Ian Altavir, Sarah Lawrence, as well as the researcher extraordinaire, Anna Matisse, Donna Fahiki, who rounds out our curatorial team. Michelle Rolf Trujillo so aptly explained about time and history. Quote, the past does not exist independently from the present. Indeed, the past is only past because there is a present, just as I can point to something over there only because I am here. But nothing is inherently over there or here. In that sense, the past has no content. The past, or more accurately, pastness, is a position. Thus, in no way can we identify the past as past, end quote. Before yesterday, we could fly, an Afrofuturist period room is a fiction of authenticity. It is a production that presents a speculative historical counter-narrative while also raising questions about time, space, and place. As my colleagues at the Metropolitan Museum of Art explain in their essay for the show, the period rooms within the Metropolitan Museum of Art encompass a range of curatorial approaches, as well as different subjects and eras, from a first century BC Roman bedroom to a 20th century living area designed by Frank Lloyd Wright. These rooms and the roles they play in a global institution such as the Met have come under particular scrutiny in recent years, questioned for their near singular focus on the domestic interiors of an affluent, predominantly white, and Eurocentric culture. A period room entices its audience in a way that is different from the approach taken in other galleries. Visitors prompted to imagine themselves as inhabitants of these evocative interiors often find their curiosity intensified by the inaccessibility of the setting, typically in the form of physical barriers. Ironically, this forbidden entry invites a kind of provocation in which audiences engage imaginatively with period rooms by projecting themselves into the constructed spaces. Every period room is a fiction, a creative assemblage of furnishings and objects that were never together in the same room at the same time. The compelling engagements of the viewer's imagination and thus the success of the period room as an immersive experience depends on the invisibility of the curator's work and on a veneer of authenticity. Yet to create a period room requires paradoxically an interpretive curatorial act, a plausible, instructive proposition of historical recreation. Through the lens of Afrofuturism, the period room that we've created brings together a range of African and African diasporic visual art and sound to reclaim what had been an intentionally buried history without temporal restrictions in our vision. The past, present, future vision of the domestic space was guided by the speculative query of what might have happened if Seneca Village, which I'll tell you more about in a few minutes, was never destroyed. The temporalities exist in relation. The interventions in the Afrofuturist period room are many, beginning with the centering of Black life and the arts and cultures of myriad African descended people for the first time in this way at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. The destruction of the peace and of the existence of a thriving Black community is and was always imminent. In 2011, the Institute for the Exploration of Seneca Village History collaborated with the Central Park Conservancy to begin an archaeological excavation of Seneca Village, a thriving community that was raised to make way for New York City's Central Park in 1855. Long forgotten in public memory until recent years, Seneca Village was situated approximately at 82nd and 89th Streets between 7th and 8th Avenues. The community began to take shape in 1825, shortly after John and Elizabeth Whitehead subdivided and sold several parcels of their land to African-American individuals, and the AMEZ Church, which needed the land to construct the cemetery. In the first 20 years of its existence, Seneca Village was almost exclusively a Black community, populated by those who wanted to escape the overcrowded, unsafe, and overtly racist neighborhoods in Lower Manhattan. In Seneca Village, they could imagine the possibility for much brighter futures, though it was less developed than the Lower Manhattan area was. With the devastation brought about by the Irish potato famine, immigrants arrived from Ireland, bringing new residents to Seneca Village in the 1840s. A small community of German immigrants arrived some years later. Seneca Village was likely an enclave in which its inhabitants could move about freely, find joy, and breathe. Though New York State abolished slavery in 1827, the conditions for Black Americans remained precarious. The passage of the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850, which encoded into the law the right of enslavers to reclaim any enslaved property that escaped to a free state, exacerbated an already highly dangerous situation for the city's Black population, particularly affecting the mobility of women and children who were under the very real threat of being kidnapped and sold into slavery in the South. In an 1836 pamphlet describing the dangers that existed in New York, the Black abolitionist and activist David Ruggles warned, quote, "My depressed countrymen, we're all liable. Your wives and children are at the mercy of merciless kidnappers. We have no protection in law because the legislators withhold justice. We must no longer depend on the interposition of manumission or anti-slavery societies in the hope of peaceable and just protection. Where such outrages are committed, peace and justice cannot dwell. While we are subject to be thus inhumanely practiced upon, no man is safe. We must look to our own safety and protection from kidnappers, remembering that self-defense is the first law of nature," end quote. Given this level of uncertainty, a settlement like Seneca Village would have presented this group of renters, landowners, and immigrants a sense of safety and relief from the stresses of everyday discrimination, a spatial and psychic buffer from the everyday dangers that existed in other parts of Manhattan. It was particularly devastating for the community then when the city began the eminent domain process to take ownership of land that would be used to create a large city park that could compare with or exceed the beauty and extravagance of the public green spaces found in Europe. As you likely know, eminent domain laws permit governments to reclaim land for public use, offering landowners arbitrary amounts of cash for their property. Over the course of American history, eminent domain processes have disrupted and upset Black communities to establish parks, more expensive housing developments, interstate roads, and other infrastructure projects that often perpetuate inequality. These processes are typically controversial, and landowners tend to fight for their rights to their plots in the courts, with governmental entities often characterizing the communities in question as bastions of criminality and or filthy blights on developing cities and towns. A New York Daily Times article, for instance, describes Seneca Village as a, quote, "neat little settlement that presents a pleasing contrast to their habits and the appearance of their dwellings to the Celtic or Irish occupants in the lower part of the park. If some of the hogs, goats, and other inmates of the shanties in this vicinity do not die of the yellow fever in the summer, it will only be because death himself hesitates to enter such dirty hovels." This was from 1856. What Black oral histories and memories had held over time, and what the 2011 archaeological project proved, is that Seneca Village was a very established community. The fragments unearthed during the archaeological dig revealed that the properties were a mix of wood frame homes, some with barns and sheds in the rear. While some of the descriptors regarding a lack of development and sensory excesses of the community might have been partially true, given that there was pollution produced by local tanneries and a bone boiling factory in the area, what the media intentionally papered over in the 19th century is that Seneca Village was actually quite a diverse and promising community. By 1855, Seneca Village was By 1855, Seneca Village was an overall rarity in New York, in that approximately half of its residents owned their property and many of its landowners had the right to vote. The literal unearthlyers surveyed at the Seneca Village site contain evidence of lives fully lived two centuries before, including fragments of thriving domestic spaces, such as pieces of glass, stoneware dishes, perfume bottle, a hair comb, a kettle, a decorative copper alloy estuchion, a leather small shoe belonging to a woman or a child, and the stone foundation of a home. Before Yesterday We Could Fly, the title of the period room is inspired by the titular story from Virginia Hamilton's children's collection, The People Could Fly, American Black Folk Tales. Hamilton's retelling of the flying African myth holds that African captives shed their literal wings that could not fit into the slave ship, but still maintained the ability to fly, while others did not possess the skill at all anymore. The narrator explains in her story, quote, "You couldn't tell anymore one who could fly from one who couldn't," end quote, suggesting that those who could fly used their ability only when necessary. At the end of the tale, enslaved people tire of the backbreaking work and ceaseless brutality of enslavers and overseers, electing to collectively fly away from the plantation. When the enslaved man, Toby, is threatened with the slave driver's whip and his enslaver's gun, he laughs at them and chants a signal to those among them who could fly, singing Buba Yale, Buba Tambi, and they flew. Those who remained were not without hope. They could self-liberate. Flight was a mindset, one that could be activated by remaining still and strategic, or through movements away from the plantation by foot, later by train and other modes of transport. Circumstances demanded enslaved people continue to live speculatively to counter the kinds of speculative financial investments and institutions that had forced them to live in such a cruel state of precarity. Numerous stories from across the Atlantic world recall the flying Africans, those captives who jumped from slave ships in hopes of returning back to their homelands. Other narratives recount the flights of enslaved people who were bound to plantations in the New World, such as the story retold in the collection of oral tales collected in Drums and Shadows. In Darien, Georgia, the informant, this is a real informant, Priscilla McCullough, stated that the flying Africans she had been told about collectively moved, first in a circular fashion, recalling a religious ring shout in which participants would sing and move about in a circle, shuffling their feet and quietly affirming the circuitousness of African diasporic time. As they shuffled, they picked up speed, and then one by one into the air, the flying Africans ascended instinctively, choreographed like birds in murmuration. By rejecting the bleak futures that awaited them, enslaved people used flight to take back control of their bodies, alerting speculators in slavery that the investments in human property were risky at best. It was not just the financial returns that were uncertain. Enslaved Africans and their descendants did not sit prone. Indeed, they returned to the idea of speculation, turning it upside down, detaching the act of speculating from the economics that undergirded slavery and into a radical epistemology for living life. For the enslaved, speculation's conjectural question of what if left open numerous possibilities for living under plantation slavery and or in flight. And so over time and since slavery, people of African descent across the Atlantic world have thought speculatively and moved in different kinds of ways toward liberation. Afrofuturism becomes one of the ways that people of African descent have in their art, in their day-to-day lives, how they comport themselves and so forth, have created a creative mode or way of thinking that uses African-based folklore and folk ways, magical realism, science and technology to imagine liberatory lives and the possibilities for Black futures. So while slavery greatly impacted African captives' relation to water, it also reconfigured enslaved people's relation to land. Stolen away from their loved ones, captive Africans would never see their homelands again. They were rendered the property of others, and in the eyes of their enslavers, these captives had lost a measure of control over their own persons. Enslaved Africans were moved from place to place at their enslavers' will, their homeland and new world loved ones left behind, from slave ship to auction block, from plantation to plantation, from rural outposts to growing cities. In the post-slavery times, Africans in America contended with legislative policies and intentionally drawn geographies that aimed to monitor, restrict, and regulate their movements by law and by force. The material manifestation of temporal fluidity within the Met's new Afrofuturist period room is realized through the open plan of a house. The vernacular structure of a 19th century wooden kitchen connects a sleek modernist frame to the futurist living room. These two spaces are inhabited concurrently, not sequentially, one centered around a brick hearth, the other by a five-sided television, and each is the focus of familial congregation, storytelling, and innovation. Both the hearth and the television are vehicles of transportation, whether alchemical or technological in spirit. And I'm just flipping through a few pictures of this space. I'll post some links in a bit so you can see more later. These items within the room include 18th century and 19th century glass, metalwork, and ceramics, sub-Saharan devotional works that represent the spiritual traditions of the residents' ancestors from across the Atlantic, and visionary new additions to the museum's collection by artists and designers of the African diaspora. Arrayed within the house, these artworks enliven the room with centuries of accumulated history, tradition, knowledge, and invention. The spectral structure and all the treasures within it inhabit a gallery clad with a spectacular repeating design by the artist Indigeka Crosby to represent the rich history layered upon the site and create a dynamic scaffolding for her composition. Crosby combined photographic images from both sides of the Atlantic in her wallpaper. She combines photographic images from both sides of the Atlantic alongside relevant archival imagery, such as the 1856 map of Seneca Village and ambrotypes of the Lyons family. The Lyons family was a very prominent Black family in the 19th century and beyond. They were educators. The patriarch of the family was also involved with the Underground Railroad later on when the family lived in Brooklyn, but they were landowners, early landowners in Seneca Village, and very important to New York history. Within this wallpaper, Crosby also invokes the lushness of the village's sylvan locale, its verdant landscape, and self-sustaining agriculture by overlaying a rich foliate design derived from the okra plant. Imported from the Americas and Africa, from Africa through the brutal Middle Passage, alongside millions of enslaved people, the okra plant is valued for its nourishing grain seed pods and cherished for its resilience and adaptability. on this distant shore. It thrives against all odds, symbolizing so much of what was never lost and what waits to be uncovered just beneath the surface. I know some of you I've spoken to who were involved with the planning of this conference have seen the room. I just wanted to let all of you know that this room opened in November 2021. It currently does not have a closing date. So if you make it to New York City, I hope that you'll take some time at the Met to come see the exhibit. So in photographs taking of the excavation process of Seneca Village, the way that life around Central Park seemingly carries on is very striking. Park visitors are seen relaxing on the grass with friends and family, while a rare person looks on with curiosity as the dig takes place. There is a tendency for people to mind their own business, particularly in a bustling city like New York City, yet many people negotiate the places that they live and visit as if all there ever was is now. This presentist way of living can render one unaware of the history and the ways that the past informs the present moment, that the past can offer lessons for being better contemporary citizens. I end with questions for all of us to ponder. What is it that we remember? Why do we forget what we once actively endeavored to remember? What are the future uses of memory? How do we grapple with these historical inheritances? Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Kate Kraczon. I want to thank you for your presentations. I have followed all of your work for some time, but it was really wonderful to have an opportunity to think more deeply about these and past projects, especially during the busy spring semester. I blocked out time and got to dive into your essays and past artworks and books. And to open the question and answer session of this panel, we already have a few that have come in. This one is from me. What are the most significant or successful examples of artistic or curatorial interventions towards problematic artworks, monuments, or sites that you have encountered, either contemporary or historical? I thought that might be a nice way to step out and then step back into the focus of the panel.
Can I just jump in and say, I'll just go first. I would say that just being involved with this particular project at the Met, I should say it without being too colloquial. I don't know. It was life-giving because it really feels, and I use the present, even though this is a work that we've done over the past 3 years, it really feels like the Met is in the middle of a moment where they're really trying to engage with those portions of its history that have either represented Black people and other people of color, other cultures, in an incorrect fashion, or just totally silenced those histories, cultures, the artworks, and so forth. So I felt during the whole process that this was supported by the administration at the Met. I feel like even though the space, when you go into the space, those of you who have been in it, it's not the biggest room in the Met. I do still feel like it's made this big intervention, and I've already seen just different ways and the kinds of projects that have been greenlit for the Met, the works that have come out since November 2021 when we opened, and those that are kind of like in process right now are really demonstrating that places like the Met have taken seriously, I think, what was kind of like a call for folks to revisit and organizations, governments to revisit the ways that they've taken great missteps and when it comes to race and culture over the years. And I see this as one of those moments. And I'm so thankful to have been a part of it where you really see a very powerful institution trying to come to terms with the bad parts of their past.
Jazz or Jasmine, do either of you have projects that you wanted to just mention that you've followed or thought that were really successful examples? Obviously, Jazz, yours is up there. As not asking you to look past your own projects of intervention, but I'm just curious if anything, especially over the last 2 years, as this conversation has become more, has entered a more popular space across the country and world.
So yes is the short answer, and it kind of goes to one of the questions posted in the Q&A, the emergence of new decorative materials, such as Sheila Bridges' Harlem Twall, which I love. For folks who are not familiar with it, it is a wallpaper that has scenes of Black joy and patterned in a toile pattern. And it's been around for some time now, actually, and has recently expanded into other materials, including China by Wedgwood and some other art things. I think actually sold by the Met, like scarves and umbrellas, things that you'd find at a museum gift store. So I'm really excited about these things where, artists are taking what seemed like an unmovable structure, like a particular printing technique, and using it to re-envision the decorative writ large. I really hope I get to Providence to see Jazz's installation because I've been in the Nightingale Brown House before, and it's just remarkable to see her pictures, your pictures of how the space is different with the draping, the silk screen, all of it. So yeah, these are the things I'm most excited about.
So Jazz, if you don't, if you want to jump in there at all, but I have so many more questions myself.
Okay, just quickly, just to say that the Sheila Bridges work appears in the period room. We have a pair of slippers, house slippers, with the fabric, and also Jasmine's correct. Like there's also clothing now with the material as well, and Hannah Biegler wore one of the dresses to the opening for the show. So it definitely plays a role there. And just to sort of piggyback too on what Jasmine was saying about the artists who are taking materials or things and repurposing them now to give sort of a critique about history and so on. A lot of the artists within the show are doing similar things. And what I love about the show is that we have US-based artists, but artists who are from the also from the Caribbean and across Africa who are involved in these processes too, and demonstrate, you know, just how interesting and those moments of kind of coalesce, but also difference, but the ways that Black people experience life under post-colonialism, post-slavery, and so forth throughout the globe has been really interesting to view. And I think also brings a different kind of lens on what we think of as like a kind of a long lost New York story, but it's more global in nature.
So we have a question specifically about the Views of North America wallpaper, and I want to preface it with one of my questions, and this is specifically for Jasmine and Jazz. How has your relationship to that wallpaper changed, if it has, over time? Both of you, I know, have been to Brown to give talks, to be a student here, to be an activist, an artist in the community, in your case, Jazz. I'm not implying that it has changed, but I am curious.
What I would say is I think that in the beginning, seeing the wallpaper and even thinking about like what the importance of the wallpaper is, I think initially I felt, oh, you know, maybe the argument to keep it or to do some sort of intervention is so that we can continue to learn from it and talk about these histories. However, we don't need traumatic, scenes of slavery and colonialism and imperialism and genocide to talk about those things, especially in our spaces where we're supposed to be nourishing our minds and such. So I think originally I felt like this is important to be here because we need to have these conversations. And I don't feel that anymore. I feel, and I've said this and I will continue to say this, for me, my intervention itself, like the imagery, obviously I did a lot of thought. I put a lot of thought into, did a lot of research and the process of physically making it was a lot. However, in some ways, it doesn't matter what I put up, because the point, I think, is for us to get used to not seeing the wallpaper so that we can imagine something else there and take it away and find other ways to have these conversations and like hold ourselves accountable and our institutions accountable so that in the future, like we know what's up and what's going on with these histories and where we're going. So that's how things have changed for me. I was like, we need to keep the wallpaper so that we can have these conversations and do these interventions. And now I think we just need to find new ways to talk about it.
Yeah, I'm with Jazz. So in, I think it was 2016, I visited Brown. And I think from researching the wallpaper, I was accustomed to it. And so it didn't jar me in the way it did upon my first seeing it. And so I similarly felt like if it's going to stay up, I wasn't convicted about it staying up, but I felt if there's a way to keep it up, it is to curate it, to not just live with it sort of benignly, but to add placards and explanations, perhaps to add Clay's original lithograph, to sort of complicate its existence so it didn't just sort of disappear behind someone in the background. And I say that was 2016 because since then, you know, public monuments to the Civil War have come down. George Floyd has been killed in the street with countless other Black people. And so today I think it should come down. And I think it's been interesting having written about it because I've actually been consulted by various people and organizations, not necessarily wanting to be told they have to take it down, but like, what can we do to not take it down, which has been fascinating. But today I would say it absolutely should come down. The pictures, such as the Hovey murals at Dartmouth, where these things exist and seeing pictures of people taking tea in front of them, I think we can't separate the sort of casualness of graphic violence in spaces of leisure from a casualness about public murder in the street. And so I think that it's important to take them down because they are wrought in violence. But I think it's also important to take them down because it's wonderful to reimagine these spaces with artists who've been excluded from working with these materials and being involved in decor. I would love if Jazz's work was the actual wallpaper in the Nightingale Brown House and all the conversation that could come from that and what it would be like to physically be in a space that had that wallpaper up. So yeah, I absolutely today, it's a sharp change from to no, they should come down. They should absolutely come down.
So we have a new question that was just added, I believe in response to what you both just said. What about leaving the panel, just a single panel of this offensive wallpaper up and interpret it as wrong so that people still understand our past? But then replace other parts of it. So actually, Jazz, I think that the wonderful thing about your installation is you allow these windows in. And Michelle, it's very similar to the exhibition structure at the Met, right? These windows in and ways of framing and kind of forcing viewers to actually pay attention to the fact that everything we encounter in institutions is framed specifically by people like curators and artists. I know I just took that question off in a different direction, but are there moments in views of North America that should remain or should be presented or preserved, or is it an all or nothing intervention in that space?
I don't have the answer to that question. I think that the questions that you brought up, Michelle, at the end of your talk of like, what do we remember? What do we forget? Why? And sort of how? Like, I think that's, those are really important questions that we should continue to ask ourselves. And with respect to the wallpaper, I think it's like, what happens if we take it away? It's these questions. If we take it away, do we forget it? If we leave it, like, what are we creating in that? And I don't think that it's like a black and white sort of like, I think it's extremely complicated and nuanced in some ways. And there are ways that the answer could continue to change. So I think that the benefit of having artistic interventions, even if the wallpaper isn't there anymore, but its ghost is there and that people continue to respond to it, that creates the space to continue to have these conversations and to even draw a reference to the original wallpaper that was installed, even if it's not there.
I think this also brings up the concept of institutional permission, right? What does the institution allow in terms of these interventions? And Michelle, as a curator, I know how challenging working across collections can be within a large institution, especially one that has multiple curatorial departments. And your Met project challenges the institution's geographic and political position as well. Were there any unexpected debates or complications that arose? I know sometimes objects in storage can't even be brought into the space of the exhibition galleries because they're not in proper condition, they need to be conserved, they're too delicate to move, or perhaps they're too sensitive to bring into an exhibition space and not fully contextualized. And Jasmine, this also, I'm sure you can elaborate on your bumping up against institutional permission and boundaries as well has intersected with your work.
I wasn't made aware of any of those kinds of, arguments within the space of the Met. One of the things that the curators who are based there were very careful to do is to include the curators, staff members, and so forth in the process early on, which is not always the way that they do things at the Met, so that we had a presentation maybe, 10 or 11 months before the show opened, where we presented everything from like sort of the kernel of the idea and then mock-ups and so forth and the items that we wanted to use, opened it up to the staff members. And so we had a meeting, I think it was at 9 or 10 o'clock one morning, and they didn't expect for maybe, a handful of people to show up, and they had the Zoom set for, a max of 300, whatever the base number is, it's like 300. And 300 people were there before 10 o'clock, and some people weren't able to get in. There was no way to change the settings. So people were really actually excited about it. And there were loads of questions about thinking about like the period room itself. And, we definitely didn't want to like insult anybody who had a very traditional framing of time, or thought about time in a very traditional way. But it was more of a sort of engaging conversation and a very heartening conversation. So even if people weren't exactly there with us, because people have a certain way that they frame history, it still was there still were very engaging conversations that happened. So I would say that the only sort of pushback were just about people trying to get on board with Afrofuturism and thinking about time in a more cyclical fashion rather than the sort of continuum that goes from point A to point Z and beyond, as a sort of straight line. That we saw more of the kind of questioning around that rather than the items that were selected for the show.
Thank you so much for elaborating on that. I know that I am supposed to end this conversation at 11:30 and we're now at 11:33. I have so many more questions that I'll ask you all individually, but I really appreciate everyone's presentations again. And the questions that were shared in the Q&A, I think we actually did cover them. So everyone was able to get their questions in. And I want to remind you all that we have a public opening and kind of mid-exhibition opening and celebration at the Bell tonight that everyone is invited to. There's food and drink to celebrate Lisa Rahana's installation that is here at Brown because of this conference and absolutely intersects with all three of your research and practice. And I hope to see a lot of you tonight from 6 to 8 at the Bell, 64 College Street. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Hey, everyone. So I just want to thank our speakers and give sort of a look ahead to the next session. This was an amazing panel. It was just so wonderful to get all three speakers and Kate Kraczon into one place to have this really important conversation. I think there's so many questions to absorb about what the decorative arts are designed to do, for whom. The reminder to keep our eye on how things like the Public Humanities Center wallpaper continue to reach beyond the grave and touch people today. The idea, you know, the question about what can be reclaimed through art today. And as Jasmine Cobb put it, the insight, as she said exactly, historic objects are not more sacred than the people who move through them. So there are all those questions which I think we can take away into our lives and to the places where we are thinking about and that are important to us. But there's a question too specifically, I think, about the Public Humanities Center and what the center and the Brown administration chooses to do with Layview, with this wallpaper, particularly when so many other institutions have chosen to take it down. And I think one thing that comes out of this conversation is, you know, really that not taking it down is a choice as much as taking it down is, and that choosing to keep something like this up is like a choice to install it afresh every single day. I didn't see any Brown administrators in this webinar who have the ultimate say about this, but I really hope this conversation pushes this issue further. So quick look ahead, we're gonna take a short break. We start in 5 minutes. Our break shrunk from 15 to 5 minutes, but I know we're not sorry for it because it was a wonderful set of presentations and conversation. Session 5 will begin at 11:40 EST, and that is titled Law, Policy, and the Levers of Change. It's on the same Zoom link, and we'll see you there. And after that section, we'll have a break for lunch. So thanks, everyone. Hey, welcome everyone. So welcome back for session 5 after that quick break of the Inheritance Conference. That was a wonderful, wonderful session with three fantastic presentations and great moderating from Kate Kraczon. And I think a lot of questions going ahead about some of the issues raised generally, but also in particular with the Public Humanities Center and our own wallpaper, which was part of that. So in this session, you will get a chance to hear from speakers about the processes that they have been involved with, where change to public buildings, spaces, or symbols required public hearings, commissions, or votes, with attention to how a range of community members and stakeholders were able to or not able to participate in this decision-making process. So a few quick notes about Zoom. If you're joining us for the first time today, feel free to submit your questions or comments as they occur to you in the Q&A box, which you can open by clicking that icon at the bottom of your screen. The session's moderator has access to that box and she'll draw from it when she moderates the panel conversation at the end of the session. The chat box is open to all, and so feel free to use that box to introduce yourself to each other, tell others where you're Zooming in from today. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Tracy Picard, a first-year graduate student in the Public Humanities Department, and she will introduce our speakers and moderator. So thanks a lot for joining us.
Hello, my name is Tracy Picard. I'm happy to be introducing the speakers for session 5, Law, Policy, and the Levers of Change. First, we have Rusty Antel, attorney, with removing offensive artwork from the Boone County, Missouri courthouse. Rusty Antel is an attorney in Boone County, Missouri. He received his BA from the University of Pennsylvania, his JD from the University of Missouri School of Law, and was licensed to practice law in Missouri. From 1981 to 1990, Antel was assistant prosecuting attorney in Boone County, and since 1990 has been a partner in the private law practice, Walter Antel and Stamper, where his primary area of practice is criminal defense. In 2016, Antel received the Missouri Bar Association Community Service Award. Next, we have Lisa Dady, Executive Director, Historic Newton, with Born of Curiosity, updating Newton's city seal. Lisa Dady is the Executive Director of Historic Newton, where she oversees 2 museums, one of which was a stop on the Underground Railroad, and 3 historic burying grounds. She has served in curatorial roles, education, and public programming and operations. After receiving a BA in Human Development and Social Relations, Dady had a 10-year social services career in Seattle before switching gears to earn a graduate degree in museum studies from the Cooperstown Graduate Program. She has worked for the Newport Restoration Foundation, the Rhode Island Historical Society, and the Culinary Archives and Museum in Rhode Island, and was for several semesters an adjunct art history professor at Selby Regina University. Last speaker is Commissioner Marita Davis Johnson, South DeKalb County, Georgia, with From Confederacy to Unity, Exchanging Symbols of Division with Symbols of Unity. Commissioner Davis Johnson has been a longtime resident of South DeKalb County, Georgia, for over 30 years. She's been a practicing attorney for the same time, concentrating in family law, and she became the first Black female judge appointed in DeKalb County courts. Commissioner Johnson is a co-founding partner of Johnson Hopewell Coleman, LLC. She holds a BA and an MA from Tennessee State University. She obtained her JD from the Thurgood Marshall School of Law at Texas Southern University in Houston, where she met her law and life partner, Congressman Hank Johnson. In 2020, Commissioner Johnson convened the John Lewis Commemorative Task Force to honor the life and legacy of Congressman John Lewis in DeKalb County, Georgia. Our moderator today is Renee Ader, Provost Visiting Associate Professor in Africana Studies at Brown University. Renee Ader holds a BA from Oberlin College, an MA and a PhD in art history from the University of Maryland. A public scholar who works at the intersection of art and history, Ader's research focuses on monuments, memory, race, and public space. She's the author of Keith Morrison, Volume 5 of the David C. Driscoll series, African American Art, and Remaking Race and History, The Sculpture of Meta Warwick Fuller. She's also written on a range of public monuments. Currently, Dr. Ader is designing the Born Digital Project Contemporary Monuments to the Slave Past in Omeka and writing a digital publication entitled Memoryscapes of Slavery in collaboration with the Digital Publication Initiative at Brown University. Welcome to all of our speakers.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Let me just make a couple really brief opening comments. Thanks to Marissa Brown and her team for putting this together. It's a massive undertaking. And thank you also for giving me the opportunity to share this story. And also shout out to the tech team for helping me get through this. I've been on Zoom perpetually for about 2 years, but never as a presenter. So this is a little bit different for me. So let me take a couple minutes to open this up and set the scene for this. My name is Rusty Antel, I'm an attorney in Columbia, Missouri. Columbia is located on Interstate 70, about halfway between St. Louis and Kansas City. The county seat is Columbia. We're in Boone County, and the city takes up about 2/3 of the population of the county. We are the home of the University of Missouri's flagship campus here in Columbia, and we have a diverse and progressive city, but we are in a state that is extremely conservative. The Boone County Courthouse, which houses our state court system, was built originally in 1909, and then there were substantial modifications and additions in 1992 and 2008. And for the story about these murals, it's important to know that the really only public staircase in the building is located at the back of the courthouse. So you walk in, walk all the way straight back, and that's the primary staircase access to the ground floor, going down one floor, and then up to the fourth floor where there's some offices. The murals in question were placed in 1995. They were painted by a local artist by the name of Sid Larson, who is probably most famous for being a painter on the Thomas Hart Benton murals that are in the Missouri State Capitol in Jefferson City. The artwork was commissioned by a group of citizens, a committee that was formed to start this process. And it was placed in 1995 in the rear stairwell on a couple of floors with no particular objection at the time. And I will say that in the 25 years since then, excluding the last 2 years, I walked past this often daily or maybe several times a day when I was in the courthouse and never really took any notice of it. Murals, and Hannah, we're about ready, I think, to start showing the images, tell the history of the city of Columbia and Boone County. And most of the images are not controversial particularly, but several of them are. So this first image that you see, and it's a puzzling image to me, is a man with a rifle aiming at a Native American who is standing in the notch of a tree. I've never really quite understood the significance of that, but that was the first image that really is disturbing. Go ahead with the next one. The next one is a law enforcement officer. You can see on his upper left chest, he's got a badge of some sort. It looks like a gun belt, is whipping a man who's been tied to a tree, and you can visibly see the welts on the individual. Go ahead with the next image. Let's do the next one then. The third one is two shirtless African Americans carrying a large beam. And the significance to me of this, Missouri was admitted to the Union as a slave state in 1821. Slavery was not abolished in Missouri until 1865. And then the final one. So this is a man who has been hanged. He's been cut down from the tree he was hanged on. There are two significant parts of this. One is the symbolism of the noose that's on the right side. That is always, I think, a frightening image. And then the other is, it looks to me, it's kind of hard to say, but it looks to me like several people kind of have their feet on him, which, you know, looks like he's probably dead, but it's a very disturbing image. So those images, those were the primary ones that we were concerned about that are bothersome. Okay, let me move now to the how this got started in June of 2021. So I take no credit for originating the idea. In June, or maybe it was early July of 2021, a friend of mine for many, many years, I've known him since I started practicing law in 1981, Gary Oxenhandler, called me up one day and talked to me about these images and how he was really bothered by them. Gary has been in practice about 50 years. We've worked on a lot of different criminal justice projects over the years. And he served as a circuit court judge from 2002 to 2016. And part of that time, he was the presiding judge, basically being the administrative judge of the court. And I had worked in the courthouse from 1981 to early 1990. And then as a criminal defense attorney since then. And like I said, I'd walked past these images many, many times and never really noticed anything about them. They just sort of became invisible to me. So our first step was to determine who had authority over this artwork. And my initial thought was, it's the judges, it's the courthouse, but that turned out to not be correct. It's the Boone County Commission. So our government for the county is a commission of three commissioners, one who is presiding and is elected by everybody in the county. And the other two represent a North District and a South District. And they make up both county executive government as well as the legislature, because they pass ordinances for the county and then they enforce them as commissioners. So our first step was to notify and let the local bar and the court know about what we were wanting to do in seeking the removal of this artwork. Gary spoke with the presiding judge of the circuit court. Really, that was almost our first step. And the court met and in a vote that was a supermajority of the judges who were eligible to vote, wanted the artwork removed. And that decision took the form of a letter from the court to the county commission. That turned out to play a really critical role when we get to the end of this in terms of understanding exactly what our agenda was. We also solicited the opinions of the local members of our Bar Association, Boone County Bar Association. It's a voluntary organization. You can join if you practice law in Boone County or you're an attorney and you live in Boone County. And there's about 300, maybe a few more members. And we sent emails to each of the members of the bar to ask them what they thought. We asked them to tell us whether they agreed with us, whether they disagreed with us, what they thought should be done, whether they wanted their opinions to be made public or not, whether they wanted their names attached. And by the end of that process, we had received about a little over 100 responses, so about a third of the members of the bar. And about 90% of those favored removal and about 10% opposed removal. The question that was posted here about the images being, or the murals being approved, they were approved, you know, by the county commission to be placed there in 1995, with the advice from this citizen committee that kind of commissioned the work basically. Our next step, and this is getting now into the middle of the summer of 2021, was to begin to engage the community. So we contacted a really diverse group of community members, leaders. Clergy played a significant role. Political people who held political office played a big role. And we asked everybody who we contacted to share their viewpoint with the commission, either in a letter or by email or by calling the commissioners. There was a pretty good response, and a lot of people told their stories and their opinions to the commission in writing in some way or verbally. The argument in terms of why to remove these now had to include question: how did this happen in 1995 and nobody was bothered by it? And the only conclusion I could draw about that was that the world has changed a lot in the last 25 years. And we are, I hope that we're a lot more sensitive to the impact of what people see, what impact that has on them. We also focused on the idea that this was a public building devoted to the law and to justice. And unlike a lot of courthouses in Missouri, everything in the courthouse is part of the judicial function. Some of the smaller counties around us, all the county offices are in the courthouse. This building is all about law and justice. And the depictions of what you could characterize as brutal extrajudicial punishment and some element of racial or ethnic prejudice undermine the court's mission of dispensing fairness to everybody who enters and to provide a welcoming environment, no matter what awful thing that you might have been accused of doing. We got a lot of comments from attorneys that their clients were very frightened of these images, and that included a lot of juveniles. So in Missouri at the time, anybody 17 or 16 or under was a juvenile. Now it's 17. And a lot of juveniles would come through the courthouse. Our juvenile courtroom has traditionally been in the basement, so they had to walk past this. And it included very young children who could be, you know, there on an abuse or neglect case, as well as juveniles facing criminal charges. And the attorneys who we spoke with reported that their clients were frightened by these images. And it's easy for me to say, it was easy for Gary to say, hey, this stuff doesn't happen. We don't do this stuff anymore. And that's true. Nothing that's depicted there has happened in the 40 years I've practiced law, or the almost 50 years that Gary has. But the images kind of overwhelm people. Even though it's not necessarily the case, it happened. I mean, it happened in the past. It shouldn't be there now. The proponent's argument was largely that the murals depicted history. Whether that's accurate or not, don't know, but our argument was, that's fine, they can be in a museum, but they don't belong in the courthouse. There was never any argument, should never have been, we didn't make any argument that the murals ought to be destroyed. They are artwork, and it's for individuals to judge the quality of the artwork. And the murals today, they were taken down. The murals today are stored in a safe and secure place to preserve them, because at some point they might be displayed someplace, I suppose. The commission allowed a pretty considerable period for comment and then scheduled a public hearing. And that's where the letter from the judges to the commission played in, because the agenda item, it wasn't Rusty Antel and Gary Oxenhandler asking to have this removed. It was the request of the court and bank, the circuit judges, to remove the mural. The hearing was done in the evening so people could attend and not miss work. And each side was given an equal amount of time for basically opening statements. So Gary and I made about 10-minute opening statements each supporting the removal. Two people spoke against removing them. One's a local attorney who is a law school classmate of mine and very involved in the local historical society. And the other was a judge speaking not as a judge, but just as a private citizen, who argued again on the historical basis that the murals ought to remain. After we spoke, commission just allowed everybody present without any limitations to make statements and tell their stories. And ultimately, I don't think that the comments by Gary and I swayed anybody's opinion about this. I think it was the opinions of people who had felt the trauma who really impacted the commission. In order to remove the murals, it would require a vote of two of the three commissioners. And when we went into the meeting, I mean, we did not have any certainty of where we stood on this exactly. We had some thoughts, but we didn't have any certainty about it. I think ultimately some opinions on the commission were changed. Again, not by the stories that we told, but the stories that the speakers told about their personal experiences. The commission did not make a ruling that evening, took the matter under advisement, and then about perhaps 2 weeks later at a public hearing, announced the decision to remove the murals. The vote was 2-0. One of the commissioners abstained on procedural grounds. There was a disagreement as to whether the order to remove should be brief, which it was, or whether a more lengthy explanation should be attached to the order. But basically, all three of the commissioners supported the removal. And in early October, the murals were removed from the courthouse and they remain in storage at this point. They were offered, have been offered to various institutions to show them, but nobody has at this point taken up on that offer. And so for me, you know, this was a successful endeavor. We didn't know anything about what we were doing going in particularly, but the important thing I think was to stay on message and for the hearing in front of the commission. The most important part of it was to remember that the agenda item for the commission that night was the letter from the judges requesting the removal of the murals.
Thank you so much, the Brown Center, for inviting me and my fellow panelists to talk. This was a great idea. And I know we're all eager to talk about how we make change in a very public way, change that we think is positive, though not everyone may agree with us. I'm gonna ask for the first slide to come up and let you sit with the image of the city seal, the official city seal of the city of Newton, Massachusetts. While I give you a little background on Newton, on the process that we undertook to come to grips with this seal, and then I'll hopefully have some time to share some observations about making change in a public way. And we'll just let you kind of do what those people in Newton have done for a very long time. They take their recycling bin to the curb and they may glance at this, they get their water bill, they see a DPW truck driving around. They may or may not take a second look at it. In Newton, we've got about 89,000 people here. It's a suburb west of Boston. One of its attractive features is in normal traffic. You can be downtown by car in 15 minutes. It's very affluent, highly educated community, most of it very affluent and is thought that way in the region. It's liberal as well. I don't think there's a Republican on the city council. The mayor is a Democrat, and the citizens by and large vote and give money to Democrats, Democratic causes. It's ethnically very white. From a ethnic and racial demographic standpoint, the second group would be Asian Newtonians at about 14%, and everyone else is under 3%. However, in the last few decades, the increase of Jewish residents has been large, and in the region, it's considered sort of a Jewish town in some ways. And the most important thing, because this is going to come up later in a big way, is that Newton's distinct in that it considers itself a collection of 13 villages. There's no one downtown with different neighborhoods. There's actually this clustering of little villages all over Newton. And those 13 villages, it's a matter of pride within and from outside the community. That's how this is known. And go ahead and bring up the second image. And you'll see, as I mentioned, on the right there is my right, your right is embedded in the City Hall rotunda, and then an earlier version of the seal. I don't live in Newton. I started working here 7 years ago, and I saw this and I thought, oh my goodness, you know, there's Native Americans on this picture. I wonder if there's ever been any discussion, concern, protests. I know as a history organization, I came to learn what is depicted here, and we certainly have taught about it. But at that time, I Googled it, I talked to colleagues, and there has never been any public commentary about this seal. It just seems to go beneath notice. So the reason I named my presentation Born of Curiosity is the process I'm going to share is really the curiosity of one single person, Mayor Ruth Ann Fuller in Newton. who called myself and the city clerk into her office in the fall and winter of 2019. And she wanted to know more about the history, what the iconography was. We had a few meetings. We shared with her the origin. We had some meetings where we discussed if it represents Newton today in the 21st century. And ultimately, I wrote up a one-pager that went on the city website on January 2020, and it sort of sat there for a while. And I guess I should, tell you what's going on here. You can bring up another slide just so you can see other versions of it. There's so many different versions of the seal around the city, and these are examples that were on older and newer city vehicles. What you see there is on the right is Reverend John Elliott, who was a missionary. He was traveling around Massachusetts trying to convert indigenous people to the Puritan religion. And he had the mandate from the Massachusetts Bay Colony to do this. It was in the charter. They wanted indigenous people to convert, not just to the Puritan religion, but to English customs and laws and life ways. He was not having success until he met Wabin, and Wabin would be, and his wife Tossensquam would be represented by the people on the left. They were the leaders of maybe 50 to 100 people of the Massachusetts tribe who lived in this area that is now known as Newton. At the time, it was known as Cohanet or as Cambridge. We were part of Cambridge, was known as Newtown, Cambridge Village. That was the scene in the 1640s. And this is depicting that meeting between them in 1646, something that actually happened, and we know where it happened. It happened in the current village of Newton Corner in Newton. Wabin decided to be open to Elliot's proselytizing. You have to understand that the situation at this time, Native folks in Massachusetts had gone through a couple of really major disease episodes, smallpox and another epidemic. They lost thousands and thousands and thousands of people. Then they had early on, when there were only a few English colonists, they could live their ways. But as the colonists increased, they were pushing west, sometimes violently, certainly with insistence. They were buying land from indigenous groups. And what Wabin, and there was some incursions a couple of times from Mohawks from New York. So there was some violent activity from the neighbors. They were in a desperate situation. And so historians really agree that what happened here is Wabin was making a pragmatic decision about the future of his people. What he really, really wanted was to secure land that could be theirs and their grandchildren's. And so he asked Elliot to go back to the colonial authorities and to promise that. Now we know, we're very fortunate that Elliot and his clerical colleagues and other folks wrote a lot about this time. We guess that it's possible that some Massachusetts people actually had an actual religious conversion. We have testimony from them. They were down the fence. We do not want to understate, though, that it's the decision was very complex. And Elliot said, yeah, I'll get you land, but he didn't say where. So 5 years later, it became clear that the colony had no intention of letting the folks stay in Cohanet, which was actually a big motivating factor for them to agree to set up what's been known as now. It's kind of a distinctive part of city history. Eventually, there were 13 praying Indian villages in Massachusetts, and this is kind of the origins of that. Not only were they to convert, but they were supposed to start wearing English clothes, farm in English ways, have gender roles that are English. And so they straddled kind of Native and English customs for a time. It turned out that they were given land, but it was west in Natick. And that's actually the origin story for that suburb of Boston, for Natick. They were establishing a praying town where indigenous people had governing authority, and that is their origin story. Natick Historical Society and Historic Newton have been working closely together for a couple of years to really dive into these stories, and I'll show you a picture of their town seal later, which depicts Elliot and Wabin, as do a lot of seals in Massachusetts, because most of them were developed in the late 19th century, and I'll talk about that. So the mayor, right around August, decided, now we're talking August of 20, excuse me for the fire trucks there, August of 2020, where she thought, you know, we really need to take a look at this. At this point, I know that she's convinced that it should change. I'm secretly convinced it should, not so secretly convinced, that it is offensive to people for a very particular reason and that it should change. So she decided to form a city seal working group, put out a call in August of 2020. And I want to read you kind of how that was explained to the community. She said, we put together some questions. The city seal was created 155 years ago. A lot has changed since 1865, which raises some key questions. What is the historical context? In what historical context was the seal designed and adopted? And what can the study of history tell us about what it conveys? Is the seal's imagery still relevant in the 21st century? Is the city's logo readable and meaningful? Is it good design? No, it's not good design. My opinion. What does the seal mean to you, if anything? So are there other graphics or words that can better portray the identity, the spirit, and the values of Newton? It's time to take a deeper look, forming an ad hoc committee. We got about 45 applicants. She asked myself as the history nerd and the community engagement manager and her administration to lead up this group. We chose 13 people. We very much wanted an Indigenous citizen on the committee, didn't happen, but we did have some important diversity. We had people living around the city in most of the 13 villages. We had a diversity in age range. We had high school student up to people who have been long retired, people who are new residents of Newton, and people whose family had been here for generations. We were looking for people with a professional background in design and in history and education. We had an art historian, a rabbi. It was a very serious group. They became instantly dedicated and very thoughtful about their process. We met biweekly from September 20 to February 21. We had one meeting with outside experts. We had one public meeting, and this is important. Unfortunately, we only had about a half a dozen people show up, but they were poignant in their comments and really pretty much unanimous that they felt that this symbol displayed a sort of cultural genocide, and it was a long time coming that we should consider changing it. That recording went up on a special webpage on the city's site for this project. By the sort of about February of 21, we submitted initial draft to the mayor. She sent us back with some feedback to push further on next steps and design suggestions. And that, of course, is the hardest thing. It's one thing, and I really want to underscore this. We consciously had the city seal group start with the question of, should it be changed? Not, oh, we think it should be changed by Mayor Ophia. We think it should be changed. And now you go out and tell us how it should be changed. You know, maybe that's disingenuous, but I was in a way kind of also earnest that we had to start there. You know what our culture in this country is like. And in Newton, there were us and them arguments going on around issues like zoning and other things. And I wanted to try for as long as possible out of the gate to not have an us versus them change, anti-change sort of paradigm start. So we authentically spent the first few meetings with the question of, should it change? And then we came up that it should change. And this 58-page report went to the mayor. Now, she sent us back. We went back in April. And now the summer of 21 in the spring, what's really on the city government's mind right now is COVID surges. What's also on their mind is the November 21 election. I knew it became clear to me nothing was going to happen with this particular question until after the election. But sure enough, it was picked up again. And the mayor, in February of 22, docketed with the city council a request for approval to proceed with the process of updating the city seal. Updating was a politically considered term, probably pretty savvy. It was important. We mentioned this to the city seal working group when we met with them, that we want to use the word updating. The word change can be very scary, right? And part of the messaging here is that in the 21st century, this emblem may not serve us any longer. And so it was kind of underscoring that concept. The question to the city council is, will you advance the city seal group's recommendation to update the seal and let us go out with an RFP to get design services to come up with new design ideas? So now the question is sitting with a committee of the city council. And it's sitting there for a couple of reasons. And let me have you bring up the next slide. We don't know. I mean, it's kind of obvious why there's dates around the outside. We don't know for sure why they chose Liberty and Union, although in 1865, you can certainly understand that Union would have resonance. And the word nonantum becomes key. When Eliot and Wobbin established their village, Wobbin asked Eliot, what should we call this? Eliot suggested nonantum, which is the Algonquin word for rejoicing. And as Eliot explained, that English were rejoicing that indigenous people were converting. So that, for the 5 years that community was there, became known as nonantum. And this, especially in the 19th century, this story looms large. This is a time period when people are romanticizing the past. White people in America are thinking of Indians, as they call them, as especially American, not European, a vanishing race, certainly not thinking of them as people who are still here and could demand rights of their own. So this artifact, this is an artifact of the 19th century more than has anything to do with the 1640s and certainly the 21st century. Now, the confusing part of that word nonantum is I mentioned the importance in Newton of villages. One of the villages is called Nonantum. It's nowhere near where this scene happened. It's on the north side of the city. It was called North Village for a very long time until the latter part of the 19th century. It started to become called Nonantum in part because there was a large mill building there. And again, it in the late 19th century, people are looking back at Native American words. They're naming streets and fraternal lodges and schools after, in this case, Algonquin words. Nonantum is also a village of immigrants. It has a very proud tradition. It was where the Irish came and the Italians came and the Eastern European Jews, and still new residents in Newton come there because it's one of the few places that you can afford to live. So it's always had an identity as a working class immigrant area. It has a parade every year sponsored by the Italian group. And now I should tell you that about a year and a half ago, the city council was brought to them was the question of changing Columbus Day to Indigenous Peoples Day. Italian Americans have Columbus as a symbol of pride. And that was a really hard decision when the city council decided to officially change the holiday to Indigenous Peoples Day. And that's how it's recognized in the schools and city government. And it really hurt. And so given that context, when it became public that the city council committee is going to be looking at this, it's the word nonantum that stuck. And folks from the Italian community, a couple of the leaders reached out to the chair of that committee. Our community engagement manager talked with her. She understood by the end of that phone call that this nonantum on the seal is not the nonantum that she's proud of. It's something very different, but it didn't matter. It just didn't matter to her. And so our sense is that in private conversations, folks that are mad about this are the people right now, privately, that the city council members are hearing from. And one of my criticisms, in fact, of how we could have done this process better is we've always meant, the community engagement manager and myself, that we would reach out to individual city council members, keep them abreast of the process. And certainly when the report was done, offer to have discussions with them about it. And when the report was done, the city seal working group was going to go on the road to neighborhood councils and any group that would have us to explain the findings of the report. We just didn't do that. You know, we get busy and it didn't happen. We still can do it and we still may need to do it because it does seem like this could languish in that committee until a vocal group of people for the idea of updating the seal comes to the fore. And so that's kind of where we're sitting with that. And you can bring up, actually, I think it's the next slide. We did solicit, I was gonna mention, one of the things I forgot to mention in the process is we did put out a survey of the community. I know on this panel, we're supposed to talk about how there are voices that are helping to make change. How did the community participate? One of the surveys that happened was our high school student surveyed his fellow students with the question, do you know what's on the seal? They didn't. Once they learned, the majority said it should change. Not everyone, but the majority said that it should change. We also put out a survey asking the community two key questions, one of which is if you could describe Newton in three words, what would it be? And this is the cloud of words. education, diversity, community, wealthy, liberal. I don't know why urban is there, but I suppose it is in some ways. That was a, we collected probably about 70 people who provided feedback through the online survey. And the other question is, if you could, what would you like Newton to be known for if, to the rest of the world? And words that came back for that were diversity, inclusion, that sort of is the spirit of the times, I think. Community, environment, and indeed, I would say characterize this community as being very concerned about the environment, climate change, gardens, trees, green things, change, safe, liberal, white, historic, and expensive. So that's kind of what they were looking at. Oh, and education is still just such a huge value. So the SEAL report includes a creative brief that could be used by graphic designers, where we put together the data of feedback and then picked apart the SEAL and talked about suggested changes. And I can, if people are curious about the specifics of that, I can certainly go into that, but I know I'm running out of time. I guess my observation about the question of making change is, you know, it's really strikes me that this didn't come from protests or Native groups expressing officially that they were offended by it. It came from the curiosity of one person, and I think it will change. I think the way it's going to move is that a very white city of liberal, well-meaning people, especially after the George Floyd incident and the huge racial justice protests in 2020, Newton has been trying to educate itself in a series of forums about anti-racism topics. It's probably this process is happening from, I don't want to say the top down, but the inside out, right? It's coming from the seat of power. And I don't want to fall into a white savior narrative here and call me out on it. Well, it's the white people in power that will ultimately see this through to the end. They're standing on the shoulders of decades of work by Native groups in the state who've called out sports teams for their Native mascots, who've called out the state seal, which is problematic, who've protested and made it very clear, that, you know, that this is not to stand. And even though it took us all the way to the bitter end to get the formal statement from the chief of the Massachusetts tribe and from the leader of the Nipmuc tribe to say it formally, we knew from all of the work that they had done how they felt about this. And so it'll be interesting to see what happens, but my prediction is that it will happen. And I think what we've seen is, when I was mentioned in my introduction that before I got into the museum field, I was in social services in Seattle in the 1990s. And I worked with a group, a volunteer group called the Northwest Lesbian Gay History Museum Project, the mouthful. We didn't have the term LGBTQ back then. And what came out of all of our work, our exhibits, our walking tours, is this theme that to make change in terms of this case, the gay rights movement, is you need this sort of radical fringe, think of ACT UP actions. And then you need this sort of more palatable to the so-called mainstream society. You need people like, at that time, there was one openly gay state senator that was trying to make incremental changes. And it's that combination, think Malcolm and Martin, that make change. And since we're in the Boston area, then you have the Bobby Kennedys and the Lyndon Johnsons and the JFKs, who, because the people in the country started changing based on the civil rights movement, or the gay rights movement, or indigenous rights movements, the politicians were finally able to do the right thing. They were pushed there, and that's where we are in Newton right now. And it is my sense it will take a combination of both well-meaning white people on the inside of power and probably a little more of a nudge, a little more of an agitation, which for me as a city employee is a little hard, but it can happen from the outside, and we'll probably get this done. So thank you for listening, and I really look forward to the Q&A session. And thank you.
Lisa, thank you very much for that. So really interesting. I have lots of questions already for both you and Rusty. So Merida, I'm going to get off screen and let you pop in.
As a participant in the movement during the 60s, I was arrested 40 times, beaten, left bloody. I've seen friends of mine, people that I knew, killed. But through it all, I never became bitter or hostile. And today, all these many years later, I don't have any hate or ill feeling toward any of the people. I still believe in a society where we can live together as brothers and sisters.
It is my honor to announce the signing of a declaration which will form the John Lewis Commemorative Task Force. We've received comments from the public about the importance of remembering John Lewis, his life, and the commitment of our beloved community, as he would say. I had the chance to know John and work with John as a congressional spouse. He was a giant of a man who loved the people, who loved his country, which he represented very well.
What an honor it is to join you in signing this declaration. I think we are all privileged to serve on this commission to honor a man whose legacy inspires us all. It is only fitting that we form this task force to give us a sense of hope for the future. So thank you, Commissioner Davis Johnson.
I think that this is a great moment in DeKalb County history.
I think John Lewis is watching and is thrilled at what we are doing, and that we remain hopeful and that we remain vigilant, and it is an honor to participate. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Patty.
Thank you.
Everything must change. Nothing stays the same. Change. No one stays the same. The young become the old, and mysteries do unfold.
Thank you, Dr. Marissa Brown and Brown University, for inviting me to be part of this distinguished group of panelists. As a member of the DeKalb County Commission, I am honored to add my voice to other presenters here discussing the topics of change to public buildings, spaces or symbols requiring public hearings, commissions, or votes. DeKalb County is one of the most diverse counties in Georgia. According to the official US 2020 census, DeKalb County's population is 464,382. A majority, 55%, is African American or Black, 36% white, 9% Hispanic or Latino, and 16% foreign born. DeKalb County seat of government is in the city of Decatur, an old granite courthouse built in 1898 in the neoclassic style sits on the square. In 1908, a Confederate monument, a reminder of slavery, Jim Crow, and white supremacy, was erected in front of the courthouse, where it remained for 112 years. The DeKalb County Commission in 2019 added a plaque that provided context to that monument. Specifically, on the marker, it states that the marker was erected to glorify the lost cause of the Confederacy and the Confederate soldiers who fought for it, and that it was privately funded by the C.A. Evans Camp of Confederate Veterans and the Agnes Lee Chapter of the United Daughters of the Confederacy. Note that the city of Decatur is also a part of Georgia's fifth congressional district, the late civil rights icon, Congressman John Lewis, served 17 terms representing the fifth district before he passed away in 2020. In light of the diversity and progressiveness of DeKalb County and the city of Decatur, it would be an affront to the legacy of Congressman John Lewis to have any such symbols represented in the fifth district. He once said, when you see something that is not right, not fair, not just, you have to speak up. You have to say something. You have to do something. A list of historical values. To some, the Confederate monument was erected at a time when DeKalb County was less diverse and as progressive and diverse as it has become today. Historians describe the courtyard monument to the Confederates as a symbol of repression. But more so, the Confederate monument represents a diametric opposite to the nonviolent collective social progress evident in DeKalb County, underwritten with the blood, sweat, and tears of that renowned cadre of civil rights soldiers and the remarkable tenacity of Congressman John Lewis, in whose district that obelisk of repression stood. Senate Bill 77, an amendment to Chapter 3 of the Title 50 of the Official Code of Georgia, provided protection to monuments, statues, and other commemorative symbols. This law, which became effective in 2019, prohibited the removal, concealment, alteration of publicly owned monuments. Actions can be brought against any person or could be brought against any person or entity violating the law and could face penalties that include the cost to repair or replace the monument and legal fees. Other debates were over which government entity, DeKalb County or the city of Decatur, owns the land where the monument stood and how to work within the letter of law to remove the monument. Generally, due to the language of this state law as written, it is prone to misinterpretations. Along with members of the community, three groups in particular petitioned the DeKalb County Commission to have the monument removed. They are the DeKalb County NAACP, Hate Free Decatur, and the Beacon Hill Black Alliance for Human Rights. Needless to say, the fight for the Confederate removal did not go unchallenged. There were considerable pushback from supporters who saw the Confederate monument as a benign symbol of yesteryear. The DeKalb History Center states on its website, "Monuments are not history. Many times throughout history, statues and monuments have been commissioned with veiled reasons, in order to push a political agenda, to glorify an ugly part of history, and even to promote the downfall of a race of people. While a monument isn't always an accurate depiction of history, it is important to learn about who commissioned it and what was happening in the time period to influence its creation. When he was a presidential candidate, our president, Joe Biden, said that Confederate monuments belong in museums and not public squares. He was best to remove them peacefully. He said it was best to remove them peacefully, and that in places where such statues stood, elected officials have the responsibility to remove them to a more suitable place, like a museum. On October the 10th, 2020, I introduced a resolution in the Planning, Economic Development, and Community Services Committee meeting to remove the Confederate monument from the square. That resolution was formally approved at the next full meeting of the Board of Commissioners on October the 24th, 2020. The City Council of the City of Decatur also approved removing the monument. But considering the Georgia law, the court ordered that finally granted the monument's removal was a nuisance ordinance signed by DeKalb County Superior Court Judge Clan Silica. In his ruling, he said it had become an increasingly frequent target of graffiti and vandalism, a figurative lightning rod for friction among citizens, and a potential catastrophe that could happen at any time if individuals attempt to forcibly remove or destroy it. On June the 18th, 2020, the 20-foot Confederate monument was removed and placed in storage. The removal of the Confederate monument is now a symbol of positive change and the equitable construct of the citizenry of DeKalb County and the City of Decatur. The DeKalb County Commission, in collaboration with the City of Decatur, signed a declaration establishing the John Lewis Commemorative Task Force. This show of unity exemplifies how concerned citizens and leaders in government could join forces for a collaborative social program. The members of the John Lewis Commemorative Task Force represent the rich diversity of DeKalb County. The members include private citizens, public officials, businesses, and organizations. The purpose of this group is to determine the best and most appropriate way to honor the late congressman. As a young man, John Lewis became a catalyst for change. Many young people like yourselves are today catalysts for positive change. I'm proud to say that actions taken by young people essentially help remove that monument of intimidation located in front of one of the most prominent buildings in our county's seat. To date, the John Lewis Commemorative Task Force has raised over $586,000 to construct a new statue in honor of John Lewis. We have commissioned an artist whose work will include a depiction of a young John Lewis. And it is gratifying to say that on January the 6th to 26th, 2021, Mayor Patty Garrett and I introduced a resolution supporting the John Lewis Commemorative Task Force's designation on the former site of the Confederate Obelisk Monument on the grounds of the historic DeKalb County Courthouse in Decatur, Georgia. As the future memorial site honoring Congressman John Lewis, we anticipate installing the new monument by August or September 2023. So thank you for affording me the opportunity to give this presentation.
Merida, thank you very much. So if the panel could all come back onto the screen, that'd be great. There you are, Lisa. So really interesting. So we have a few minutes because lunch starts a little late, so we can roll over a little past the 1 o'clock time. So first of all, thank you for your really interesting presentations. One thing that strikes me immediately is the way in which all three of you were involved in processes that really are, in some ways, are top down. I mean, I'm really intrigued by this, that you all are working basically. Rusty, you had judges aligning with you. Lisa, you had this big community outreach, but also the mayor asking, why do we have this seal? And with Merida, really using the law, not using a nuisance ordinance, right, as a way of removal. I mean, I was really fascinated by that. So in some ways, your process doesn't necessarily mirror the process we see, let's say, in some spaces, right, where the Confederate monument, as an example that Merida spoke about just now, have been graffitied, but also publicly removed by groups of young people during protests. We've seen that happen as well in real anger, or removed, for example, in the case of New Orleans in the middle of the night. So I thought one of the things that we could, and if you have questions, please put them in the chat or in the Q&A so that I can kind of track them. But I'm wondering, because I think that you actually asked a really good question, Lisa, that we can kind of start there. How do we make this change in this public way? And if you could each talk a little bit about this idea of community. I thought you each used it slightly different, who the community is that you are addressing. I mean, I thought, Lisa, it was fascinating that, in fact, it was a fairly limited group within the villages that finally responded. So I'd be interested in you all talking a little bit about that. And if you have questions for each other, just let me know. So let's just start there and then move forward. I have other questions to ask as well. Whoever would like to start talking.
So you're observing that the that it was a very small group at this point who's had any chance to really comment or wrestle with the seal. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and interestingly, I'm using Indigenous Peoples Day, the holiday change. My sense there, there was an Indigenous Peoples Day group that had been around for a couple of years, and that is comprised of some Indigenous folks. We have a couple of Taino folks there on that group, and some white women who are so committed to anti-racism work in Newton through like the public schools. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's not, one of the things I'm observing is, you know, the newspaper, the local newspaper here is dying. It's dead, in fact. Gannett is going to be pulling it. So where do people have a chance to talk? We have a blog called Village 14. We do some of our work and the Indigenous Peoples Day work. Ended up in the Boston Globe, but it's a very small piece. No, so where can we involve a greater number of people? We only had 6 people in our community response meeting. So it Newton makes itself known when things finally come to the head, when there's going to be a vote. And so I'm looking forward to the possibility that there will be city council meetings where people may come out vocally. But it's been, the feedback has been dribbles of emails that come into me and the mayor. And you don't have a sense. I mean, really, when you think about it, who cares about a city seal, right? I mean, what? They don't know what's going on. They don't care. And it may just be the sort of silent group of apathetic people that allow change to happen. And so, I don't know. I mean, I guess that's why we have elected representatives, right? Is it's their job to kind of bring the voice of the people to the forum where change is made.
You know, Lisa, what I appreciated is that the mayor, in fact, looked at the seal and said, we have to have a conversation. And we're not often seeing these changes driven out of the mayor's office, in all honesty, right? So in that case, I was really fascinated that she said, we need to actually, and of course, 2020, our lives were completely disrupted. And I don't mean that in a bad way, but the way that we see the world, I would hope would not go back, that those protest movements really, I think, across the board opened the eyes of many Americans. And then I want to have Merida and Rusty jump in, but I do have one quick question, Lisa, if I can tack on, and it's really the issue of nudity in the seal and this play where they seem to go back where they clothe and unclothe. And like, what is that about? Is it trying to, you know, make the seal more, you know, acceptable to the villages in Newton? I'm just really curious about that shift in the design over time.
So the seal was adopted in 1865, and there had been in art and in popular culture, there had been drawings and etchings of this Eliot scene. Eliot's been revered. He's been written about. And so whoever, we don't know, but whoever designed the seal almost copied some of these widely available prints. And we don't have images of authentic images of Massachusetts people or Nipmuc people from the 1640s. And so they were kind of making it up as they went along. And sometimes they got it right and sometimes they didn't. And so what is really wonderful though, and I think it's important to point out, is already by the time Eliot is doing his work, I mean, he's one of the reasons why people look back at him with some reverence is that he did bother to learn the Algonquin language in the first Bible printed out of printing press in Harvard University, having worked with Indigenous speakers of Algonquin, he created a Bible in the Algonquin language. And that is something that should never be overlooked as an important step. The letter from the sachem of the Massachusetts people at Ponkapog suggested that Massachusetts Massachusetts people should appear on the seal in colonial dress, because by that time, a lot of them were wearing a mix of colonial and indigenous dress. Elliot could be there as well, is a single person dressed in the same way as and depict Wobbin, also dressed in English clothing. So it's just a matter of people's having their own idea, white people having their own ideas of what indigenous people look like.
Okay, yeah. So Rusty and Merida, do you want to jump in?
You know, I would say that DeKalb is a very, DeKalb County, as I stated, and the city of Decatur is a very diverse community in many ways. And so we had the participation. I think that what was happening in the country at the time brought to the forefront the need for change, and change happens. And so the community, all parts of the community and the church and the government came together to make that change. And the we have a Republican conservative type government in the state of Georgia. So the question became, how can this be removed? The legislature just prohibited this. And so we had a judge that replaced a controversial judge, because that judge that was sitting in the seat sent Dr. Martin Luther King to prison at Reedville in Georgia for a traffic violation. So the judge that determined, Judge Clan Siliger, the judge that determined that it was a public nuisance upseated the judge that sent Dr. King to prison. And so we moved quickly after that verdict.
Okay.
Before anyone filed an appeal, before anyone contested it, and in the middle of the night, 2 days later, it was removed. And so no one filed an appeal until about a year later. And I think that at that time, I think that Rusty can tell you it's too late. So, yeah, and so we were blessed, I think, with the how everything unfolded.
Yeah.
But we had tremendous community support.
Well, and clearly in your case, in Decatur, you really needed that, actually the protests of the young people to raise how this issue, this obelisk, was such a problem, right? Because they had graffitied it. Am I understanding the image correctly?
Yeah, but you know, like I said, it was it wasn't only the young people. People of all ages, of all colors, of all creeds came together. But I think it was that national reaction that people saw on TV pertaining to, and then the killing of
George Floyd,
you know, just the killing of young people, and what happened in South Carolina. So it's a combination of events that brought the entire community together. And so we were very fortunate to have that. And then we have a very progressive commission. And so our commission voted unanimously to support this, as well as the city council of the city of Decatur.
Okay, thank you. And Rusty, I think yours wouldn't have happened if those judges hadn't and the lawyers hadn't signed that letter. I mean, it seems to me without that input from the lawyers and judges working in the building, and you very smartly taking a survey of the Bar Association to get a sense of how that particular legal community that's got to enter the building, the users of the building, as well as your really powerful statements about youth actually encountering that. Imagine being a young kid in foster care having to encounter that, right? If you're in the courthouse, seeing a lynched body or seeing these semi-clad African-American, what effectively are enslaved laborers, but also that a white man pointing a gun at an indigenous person, and this is supposed to be the place where you think justice is to be served. So I was really struck by the way in which you all handled the lawyers and judges.
Yeah, we were really, when we were in the process, really moved by the stories we were told. Our public defender probably represents close to 70%, certainly two-thirds of the people charged with criminal cases, and they are not widely trusted by their clients. And a lot of the comments were from public defenders, and then from the attorneys who represented juveniles, that it was very frightening. And it didn't matter what we thought about it. It was the people who told their stories. Now, I'll tell one of the stories that was told at the public hearing. This was a younger African-American attorney, and she told a current day story. This is not like in the past. She had been at our local Sam's Club before the hearing, with her daughter, and her husband came over and helped an older white lady load a big case of bottled water in her cart. And just as that was happening, the lady's husband came back and he remarked to his wife, he said, I see you got a slave. Now, that is 2021 in the United States of America. And I don't know what her husband's reaction, I don't think she mentioned that. Her reaction wasn't what was important. It was her four-year-old daughter hearing about slavery, really for the first time. I think, she had decided, she and her husband thought, we got to tell our daughter about this, but four is too young. And then she hears this. And that, maybe if there was one comment that anybody who spoke that evening made that moved the commissioners, I think that might have been it. Not for me. I'm a privileged white guy, but for many people of color, it's a present day problem. It hasn't gone away.
Yeah. It's interesting because I think there are those kinds of stories being repeated all over the US actually. And I think we have this notion that when people say, you got a slave, that's not just happening in the South, right? That doesn't just, for example, Merida, happen in Georgia. That it's happening everywhere. It's happening in Seattle. It's happening in Newton. It's happening in Florida. It's happening right in Chicago, in these cities, in these places we think that this kind of real ignorance, quite frankly, and hate kind of lives on. So I'm really struck by that because I think that's really powerful. So I'm really interested in how communities get to engage these questions. And one of the things that's exciting for me as a scholar who's writing on these kinds of projects is the fact that you were very careful in how you and thoughtful in the way that you got community engagement, and that people are vested in public spaces. They are vested in what we're seeing in those. And even if it's just a little seal, Lisa, I think it's significant. And I think everyone should actually occasionally, states and cities need to go back and look at what their seals look like, because they are telling historic narratives about that state that are often founded in white supremacy. And so I think that's really important. And whether or not we read the subtext with the Newton one, where we have this really complicated kind of conversion narrative, or we understand what's happening on the town square in many southern cities as places of violence, and particularly extra legal violence, and I include Missouri as kind of a southern space where this extrajudicial killings often occur. One of the things that, and maybe this can be my last question, we don't have any questions in the chat, but one of the things that was really interesting, Commissioner Merida, that you raised was this idea of what is a symbol of unity? You know, now you've taken down your murals in Colombia, you're rethinking your seal, you're rethinking what that John Lewis Memorial will be about, that space to honor his really dedication, right, to the to the state of Georgia, but to really to the nation, really in important ways on the civil rights advocacy of John Lewis. So I'm wondering, like, what is a symbol of unity? What does that look like for, you guys haven't begun Newton, the redesign, but what does that seal look like? How is it inclusive?
I think that, you know, I think that unity should represent respect for others and love. Because the only way that, in my opinion, the only way that you can unify a group, you must first respect the individuals in that group. Because if they are not respected, you cannot unify. So, you know, John spread love with all of the hate that he encountered. You know, I was sitting in, and this is a story that I will remember from John. And I was blessed and honored to get an opportunity to engage with him because my husband is a congressman, and he was, and he is part of the Georgia delegation that John was in. And one of the things that John stated was that he was not bitter. And you can't take bitterness with you to unify. He stated that he was not bitter. And when he met a particular person from the 60s that caused much hate and damage to him and his colleagues, that when they met, they hugged, they cried together, and they forgave. You know, and so you have to respect individuals to unite. And so that's what I've taken from John. You have to forgive. You don't forget, but you have to forgive, and you have to move past, and you have to understand that your belief is not the only belief. And it's not always the only way. And so we've done that in, I think that we've done that, or we try to do that. We strive to do that every day in DeKalb County and the city of Decatur. And being that we are so diverse, we respect and appreciate that diversity.
Renee, if we still have time, that question of unity, unity or at least majority to make change. And one of the through lines for me is, like I said, if it devolved into us versus them right away, we were gonna just be lost. The process would have been painful, and it might not have made change. So I remark on if it had become all about Native Americans are mad, guilty white liberals are going to give in to their demands, that makes a lot of people bitter. And it makes, and some of the responses is, you know, the woke mayor, that's the word now, woke, I think it started off PC mayor. The conclusion in the report, and this is the message that I hope we can carry through, is written this way: the conclusion that the city seal should be changed can nearly be summed up in one sentence. Picture it as a colonial authority telling a people that their ways of living and worshiping are wrong. Certainly most Newtonians would not want a symbol of cultural arrogance to represent their city made up of many faiths and cultures. So the point here is we're not changing it because some Native Americans are mad. We're changing it because if you were to ask people in Newton if they embrace the concept of missionary work, of proselytizing, of asking people to change, there's very few people in this community that think that missionary work is a good idea anymore. It's ironic, you know, our mayor is Jewish. We have a lot of Jewish people here. We have a growing population of Hindus. How can you have a community that's seen this way and yet the state is portraying one true religion, Puritan Christian religion? And that's where we're going to get some measure of maybe not unity, but tolerance and majority around the concept that we can all see this. We're not bowing down to a vocal minority. We are all hopefully someday going to embrace the concept that, oh, that doesn't represent who we are in the 21st century.
Thank you for that. And Rusty, if you have a few, we're at our time. So Rusty, if you had if you wanted to say anything else, and then I'll say thank you to you all.
No, I have nothing further to add. It's been a great experience and love doing it.
So, you know, I just thank you very much, Lisa, Rusty, and Merida. I really appreciate you participating in the panel and actually to offer a different kind of way of how both really governments thinking about resolving some of these issues we have, whether it be in public space, in our public buildings, but also what I would call is the seal as a public object that people are encountering, as you say, on the recycling bin, but also in government when one enters. I appreciate that Tracy Picard for the introductions, but she also, if you didn't see, dropped in what our seal from Rhode Island looks like. And I would argue maybe we need to actually start a huge conversation about rethinking the seal here in Providence, which is super complicated with Roger Williams, right? And his slave owner and all of these other issues that you could unpack around that. But thank you very much. And I think, Marissa, is that it for now?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks
to everyone. Thank you all very much.
Yeah, thanks. So I can't sum it up better than Renee did just now, so I won't. But I'll just draw a line between this conversation and the first one of the morning, which session 4, where the art historian Jasmine Cobb said, historic objects are not more sacred than the people who move through them, talking about decorative art and racial representation in decorative arts. So again, I think coming back, this issue of paying attention to the way that people who use a space are impacted by it and moving away from valuing the artwork over people. And the Providence City seal is ripe, and so is the fact that although there was a vote that changed the official name of Rhode Island and took away Providence Plantations from the official name of the state, that is carved into the marble of the State House still in many places. And it's throughout the State House, you will see Providence Plantations. So I think there's certainly a conversation to be had that is local. So we're going to take a lunch break until 1:45 when the final session of the conference begins. That is titled Looking Back, Looking Ahead. The speakers include Shondine Brown Dine, who is the RISD Museum Henry Luce Curatorial Fellow for Native American Art, who is sharing about the removal of the Hovey murals at Dartmouth College in 2017. Raphael Morris, zooming in from St. Louis, he is board president of the Greenwood Cemetery Preservation Association, and he's speaking about his efforts to preserve this historic Black cemetery. Finally, Anton Troyer, who's Ojibwe, he's also professor of Ojibwe at Bemidji State University. All of the speakers are going to be looking back on actions and decisions that were taken about 5 years ago that resulted in sometimes removal, sometimes protection of certain spaces. And they're going to be reflecting on how communities and different people have felt about those decisions 5 years on. The moderator for that panel is Ken B. Phillips, who's director of diversity, equity, and inclusion at Brown University Libraries. And we will run on the same Zoom link. So enjoy your lunch and we'll see you at 1:45. And thanks to the speakers and to Renee, the fantastic moderator for today. Bye.